Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shall we start straight away with whatever business we have in mind?
We were with Hadhrat on his arrival to UK, to London.
Oh yes, yes. That was broken somewhere. When was it broken?
After the phone call from Pakistan.
You see, I have been sorting it out. There was some confusion about it, because the telephone call was not after, not in the morning, but it was in the preceding night. So I discussed this with Aftab Sahib, and I have told him to consult his papers to let me know exactly what the time was when he received the call. Because the first impression I remember, in which I mentioned during my first address here, is the right one. Find out from there. And after thinking about for a while, I remember that I told them the telephone call received by the ambassador here was around 3:30 in the morning London time. You see? No. 3:30 in the morning Pakistan time. Right? So if it was 3:30 in the morning Pakistan time, it had to be in the evening preceding, you see, around 5 hours less, about half past ten.
Half past ten, yes. Before midnight.
Exactly, before midnight. And that was the time when he could have called Aftab Sahib, because the day was not yet over here in London. And that also shows that the contact was made about 2 hours after my departure from Karachi, because the plane was delayed by the immigration department or somebody, we don't know, by one hour. While the KLM authorities made us clearly understand that the delay was not from them, and they wouldn't disclose why. But this much they told us, that the delay is not from us. Car was sent at time and it was sent back. So 1 hour they must have taken in trying to contact the authority. And when they did, the panic it created was, you know, responded to by immediately giving a call to the ambassador here. Now these are yet, you know, facts which have to be sorted out and finally ascertained regarding the time, etc. But in brief, this is what I tell you. No, later on I thought, I pressed my memory to sort it out, and then I remembered, yes, in the final from the first speech, whatever I said during my first address was exactly right.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. كنا تحدثنا مع أمير المؤمنين في لقاء سابق عن مجيئه من باكستان إلى لندن، وروى لنا حضرته المشاكل التي حدثت هناك والمؤامرات، وبين لنا أين يد الله تعالى، كيف تدخلت وكيف أفسدت عليهم خططهم، وأنه خرج من باكستان عزيزا مكرما في شكله وهيبته وملبسه وكل شيء حتى وصل إلى لندن. هنا في لندن جاءت رسالة تليفونية إلى السيد أفتاب خان، وهو أمير الجماعة في بريطانيا.
Not at that time.
لم يكن في ذلك الوقت.
Just an ex-ambassador of Pakistan, ex-civil service man. So that is how he was known to the ambassador here.
والسيد أفتاب خان كان سفيرا سابقا ومعروفا للسلك الدبلوماسي هنا، فسفير باكستان في UK اتصل به لأنه يعرف أنه أحمدي، ليعرف ما هي الأخبار والأنباء.
Right.
سيدنا أمير المؤمنين كان أخبرنا بالمواعيد والساعات بالضبط، ولكن لم تكن واضحة بالنسبة لنا، فراجعها ووجدها كالآتي. أمير المؤمنين غادر، كان المفروض أن تغادر الطائرة مطار كراتشي بعد منتصف الليل بقليل، ولكنها تأخرت ساعة هناك، وتبين من أهل الذين يعملون في الطائرة أن هذا التأخير ليس بيدهم، لأن سيارتهم أرسلوها لتصحب حضور إلى الطائرة، ولكن رجال الأمن صرفوها، فالتأخير هو من جانب رجال الأمن الباكستانيين الذين كانوا في ذلك الوقت يجرون الاتصالات التلفونية يمينا ويسارا ليعرفوا كيف يتصرفون في هذه المشكلة. الرجل الذي أمامهم اسمه طاهر ميرزا طاهر أحمد، وهو ليس الممنوع من السفر، ولكن الممنوع من السفر هو ميرزا ناصر أحمد رئيس الجماعة الأحمدية، وهو ليس أمير رئيس الجماعة الأحمدية لأن الله قد توفى، والرئيس الحالي الإمام الحالي هو سيدنا ميرزا طاهر أحمد. فكانوا محتارين ماذا يتصرفون، فتأخرت الطائرة ساعة ثم انطلقت الطائرة. المهم أن الرسالة التلفونية الهاتفية كانت بتوقيت 3:30 بتوقيت كراتشي، أي بعد ساعة ونصف من مغادرة أمير المؤمنين لباكستان. فورا اتصلوا به، وطبعا هو ما كان يستطيع أن يتصل بأحد لأن كان ذلك يكون في 10:30 مساء، فاضطر للانتظار إلى الصباح حتى يتصل بالسيد أفتاب خان ليعرف منه الموقف. أمير المؤمنين يبين من هذا كيف كان قلقهم وكيف كان انزعاجهم وكيف هم يتابعونه وكانوا يريدون أخباره بالتفصيل.
Now, this was a big great shock both to the government of Pakistan and to the mullahs in particular, because we have discovered many things from then now till now which indicated positive signs of conspiracy between government and the mullahs. Of that I have spoken already. Now I'll tell you things which happened afterwards in panic. First of all, the reaction of the chief of intelligence bureau, that he doesn't wait till the next morning, he immediately calls the ambassador and wants him to find out. And he told him to go straight away to Zurich. Geneva, and find out. Now, why was such panic? If I had left ordinarily, what was the problem? Secondly, it's very important to note that immediately an inquiry was launched as to how on earth could Mirza Tahir escape. They said escape, despite the specific orders from General Zia that he should not be permitted to leave the country. Now this revealed some very interesting facts, and throughout you see the hands of Allah so clearly working that even only the blind cannot see, the rest should know, understand what was happening. During the Hijrah, if it is blessed by Allah, these things happen. Eyes are blinded, people's minds are befogged, ordinary simple things are ignored, and that is how it always takes place. It so happened, very interestingly, that in 1983, my passport had run out. So I went to, a year after my being Khalifa, and I went to the passport officer for renewal, and he asked me to wait for a few days, and then he renewed it and handed it over to me. Now, at that time, I had no idea as to the problems he would face because of this. But after I left, immediately, he was plagued by the visits of various intelligence agencies. Why did you have this passport paid? Why shouldn't you be removed from office for this blunder? So he said, he was an ordinary citizen of Pakistan, he had been issued a passport. I, on the strength of that, I didn't make any mistake, didn't violate any law of the land. Why are you asking me? He said, didn't you know that he was prohibited from leaving the country? So if he were prohibited, why did you issue a passport? So then he remembered, he said, look here, I remember a letter being issued to me prior to the event of his issuing the passport to me. And early 1983. The letter was signed by Zia himself. It was taken, the matter was taken so seriously that to his memory, we found out from him, the letter was signed by General Zia himself, and it said, Mirza Tahir Ahmad, Mirza Nasir Ahmad, the fourth head of the Ahmadiyya community is not permitted to leave the country from any borders, by any means. Just a short, crisp order and signed. Now, I'm not sure whether it was signed by him or on his behalf by the officer, but the order, according to him, was conveyed and dictated by Zia himself. But because he made this mistake of giving the wrong name to the fourth caliph, nobody dared to change it. You see? So the inquiry was never made as to who made this stupid mistake, because Zia was still alive, who dared to challenge him? So it started, emanated from him. This view was further supported by a very highly placed Pakistani officer in the central government who in Karachi, who told a friend in Karachi exactly the same thing. He said, you know what happened was that Zia dictated the order, and because he was used to relating with Hadhrat Mirza Nasir Ahmad, my predecessor, so his name came automatically to him. And the stenographer wrote exactly as he dictated. He was the king, he was a demigod of the period. So this was what started all the problems.
Alhamdulillah.
For them. How fascinating. But more, there's more to it. This officer, passport officer, said, look here, I'm not to be blamed because I had no legal right to deny him a passport when it was already issued by you, and he had been holding this passport, traveling on the strength of this passport to many foreign countries, so I had absolutely no legal authority to stop it. And the name was Mirza Nasir Ahmad. He said, but I suspected this mistake. And on my own, I repeatedly contacted, before issuing this passport, repeatedly tried to ring the Central Intelligence Bureau and try to find out from him if there was a mistake, it has to be corrected. And he said that it so happened that every time I rang, there was no response. The telephone always was engaged until I got tired and I said, all right, you know, so give the passport. Another thing, the same thing must have happened the night when I was leaving. The telephone kept ringing, nobody raised it. Nobody lifted it. Normally it doesn't happen. So he had 3 days for his trial and no answer, so he said, all right, let it go as it is. So that is how the passport was issued to be. Then inquiry was made from the DC Jhang. I told about that.
Yes.
So this was the panic of the government, and how God's hand helped me out of this country is further supported by the view that I travelled all the way by car from Rabwa to Karachi during the broad daylight. Never changed my dress. My kafla was with me. And one of the agencies, perhaps the same Fokara, you know, who posed as Fokara, they reported it immediately to the government. They said, we suspect, because they hadn't seen me clearly, because they were more interested in money. So they said, we suspect that Mirza Tahir Ahmad has left for Karachi by road. Now this is ascertained positive report. It was processed in the center and they said there must be fools who are saying there, because the 4 other agencies had reported to us that Mirza Tahir Ahmad has left for Islamabad, perhaps to meet General Zia. So how could be all these 4 wrong, and so many people are witness to seeing a convoy going towards Islamabad, so he has to be wrong. And the only person who was right, he was considered to be wrong. Otherwise, from there to Karachi, from Rabat to Karachi, there were 750 miles of road, busy roads, which we covered. Any time they could have inquired, you know, just wrote, written to any SP of DC, and he could have blocked our way and found out. So, they couldn't stop. Now comes the more another interesting part regarding my decision that if I'm wanted for any inquiry by the government of Pakistan, I would certainly not go. Because I know the value of Khilafat, but Allah knows better. You know, it is His, in fact, prerogative and everything. He is the Wali, ultimate, shall we say, Wakil for all these things. He should decide. So they tried to argue, you know, you, this is very important, you make a mistake. I said, we'll do it within the four walls of the law and proprietary. I will not do anything improper, I will not break any law. If something happens then Allah knows best. So how Allah did it, this I'm telling you. The chief of the KLM, the chief of KLM, he advised us to take the Monday plane rather than that of Wednesday. Now on Tuesday morning, the overall supreme head of the Anjuman Ahmadiyya Pakistan, Hadhrat Mirza Mansur Ahmad Sahib, he received a call. It's a very panicky call from the operator of telephone exchange in Dabwa. He said that Mirza Tahir Ahmad must be found immediately. We are trying very hard because the governor wants directly to speak to him. So Mirza Mansur Ahmad said, what is the panic about it? Find out where he is and do it, or do what you like. So he said, but he is not to be found. He said, all right, tell the governor that he is not to be found. Then the governor said, whoever is the second highest officer, Ahmadiyya Jamaat official in Rabwa, contact me with him. So he was put through directly to the governor of, Mirza Masura was put through to speak to the governor. And he inquired from him, would you tell me where Mirza Tahir Ahmad is? He said, and rightly so. I was in the plane at that time. No, I was in London already. But what I was doing, what was happening, he didn't know much details. He said, I know that he is not here. The rest, find out. He was very clever in saying, so that he may not tell lies, but his ignorance as to exactly where I was at that time, that helped him evade the issue. He said, I know he is not here. He said, but where is he? Then you will find out where he is. So I must have him immediately because I want him to come to meet me in Governor House, Lahore. And I must speak to him. It's very urgent, immediately. So Mirza Sadiyam students have said, all right, you get him, do whatever you like, but I can't produce him. Forget about it. And that call ended. Now that was the plan, in fact, to call me to the governor house, to serve me with a notice of this implication with the murder of Mr. So-and-so. And from then on, it was just a matter of simple, pre-decided, predestined procedures. So that is how Allah saved us. You know, that brainwave of the KLM in charge was not just his own brainwave. It was, you know, yuha kana yuha ilahe, according to my belief. Like it is mentioned in the question of honeybee, that God revealed to her, oha rabboka ila nahle. So this way goes on, you know. People don't realize that this way, but minds are moved. And when we inquired from him later on, why? He said, no, I had no idea, no danger. I just thought that this flight goes through Abu Dhabi and the other flight go direct to Athens and from then on to other places. It was just a hunch, just no reason why I said it. He did not relate it to any danger, you know. But how, this is how Allah worked.
يقول أمير المؤمنين أنه بعد وصولي إلى لندن هذا أزعج الشيوخ وأزعج الحكومة وجاءت الأخبار بعد ذلك وتبينت وتكشفت أن هذه المؤامرة كانت بين الجانبين بين المشايخ وبين الحكومة وسأبين لكم أين يد القدر يد الله سبحانه وتعالى كيف تتدخل في هذه المسائل في هذه الأمور تكون أشياء بسيطة ربما لا يلتفت إليها الإنسان ولكن هذه الأشياء البسيطة العين البصيرة ترى فيها أصابع الله أما العمي فهم لا يرون هذا لأن مثل هذه الأمور الصغيرة هي التي يرتبها الله سبحانه وتعالى واحدة بعد الأخرى حتى توصل إلى الهدف الذي يريده الله يقول حضرته أن أول شيء استخراج جواز السفر في عام 1983 كان جواز السفر لحضرته قد انتهى ولا بد من تجديده فذهب لتجديده وحصل عليه وجددوه هذا الرجل الموظف في الجوازات الذي جدد لحضرته جواز السفر جاءته أفواج من المخابرات تحقق معه كيف أخرجت له هذا الجواز ألا تعرف أنه هناك أمر بمنعه من السفر قال أن هذا الشخص ليس هو الذي جاء الخطاب به الجواز هو باسم مرزا طاهر أحمد بينما الأمر الذي عندي وأعرفه بمنع الخليفة السابق الخليفة الرابع مرزا ناصر أحمد وهذا ليس مرزا ناصر أحمد وأنا ليس هناك أي شيء ضده فلا أستطيع أن أمنعه أو لا أعطيه جواز السفر ومع ذلك فأنا شككت في هذا الموضوع واتصلت بالمسؤولين تلفونيا عدة مرات ولكن كل مرة أجد الخط مشغول أو ليس هناك أحد المهم أن الاتصال بينه وبين المسؤولين في المخابرات لم يتم هذه ليست مسألة بسيطة الله سبحانه وتعالى هو الذي يدبر هذه الأمور وفي النهاية الرجل أصابه الملل فأخرج جواز السفر وانتهت هذه القضية النقطة الثانية أن أمير المؤمنين غادر ربوة إلى كراتشي لمسافة قدرها 750 ميل ساعات طويلة في الطريق وكان من الممكن أن يوقف في الطريق هؤلاء العصابة من رجال الشرطة الذين رأوا السيارات وألقيت إليهم النقود وانشغلوا بجمعها بعد ذلك شكوا في هذا الموضوع وأبلغوا المخابرات بأننا نشك في أن سيارة فيها مرزا طاهر أحمد اتجهت في طريقها إلى كراتشي عندما بحثت المخابرات هذا الموضوع قالوا هذا الرجل مجنون هناك أربعة أفراد من المخابرات أخبرونا بأن حضرته ذهب إلى أربع فروع من المخابرات أبلغتهم أن حضرته ذهب إلى إسلام أباد ربما ليقابل ضياء رئيس الدولة ضياء الحق فلا يمكن أن الأربعة يخطئوا وهؤلاء يعني مستواهم لا يسمح وكان من الممكن لو حاولوا للحظة واحدة أن يتصلوا بأي نقطة من نقط المرور في أي بلد من البلدان لهذه الساعات الطويلة أن يوقفوا السيارة ويجدونه داخل السيارة ليست هناك مشكلة ولكن يد الله هي التي أعمت بصيرتهم ولم يفكروا في هذا الموضوع أو لم يتم على يدهم هذا الموضوع نقطة ثالثة KLM مدير الشركة في كراتشي رجل ليس باكستانيا وليس مسلما وليس أحمديا ولكنه هو الذي يتم التعامل معه في السفر لأمير المؤمنين وكبار الجماعة إلى أوروبا وهو الذي اقترح كان موعد السفر المقرر يوم الأربعاء وهو الذي اقترح بشدة أن يكون السفر يوم الاثنين فتغير موعد السفر إلى يوم الاثنين في يوم الثلاثاء كنا نعرف أن أمير المؤمنين اشترط أنه لابد عندما يسافر ويغادر باكستان لابد أن يغادرها بشكله وهيئته واحترامه وشخصيته، ليس هناك تنكر. أيضا إذا صدر في ذلك الوقت أي استدعاء له، أي ورقة للاستدعاء، فإنه لن يسافر ولابد أن يذهب للقاء المسؤولين، لأنه يعرف أن الله سبحانه وتعالى هو ولي الأمر وهو الوكيل وهو الذي يعرف خلافته ويعرف قدره وهو الذي يصون هذا الموضوع. أنا لا يمكن أن أعطيهم فرصة أن يسيئوا إلى مقام الخلافة ويقولوا هرب أو يقولوا مثل هذه الأقوال، والله سبحانه وتعالى هو الذي في يده المقادير. وهكذا كانت يد الله، أن هذا الرجل الذي لا دخل له في القضية إلا أنه يدبر موضوع السفر هو الذي طلب بإلحاح أن يكون السفر يوم الاثنين، وفي يوم الثلاثاء اتصل، كان عامل التليفون مذعورا يبحث أين 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 مرزا طاهر أحمد ويبحث عنه، واتصل بحضرة مرزا منصور أحمد صاحب المسؤول الكبير في أنجمان أحمدية الإدارة التي تدير الجماعة الأحمدية في ربوة، قال له وما الذي يزعجك؟ قال إن حاكم من البنجاب يريد مقابلة، يريد أمير المؤمنين. قال قل له ليس موجودا. فطلب هذا الحاكم أن يتصل بأي شخصية كبيرة في الجماعة فوصله إليه، فسأله أين مرزا طاهر أحمد؟ قالوا له هو ليس موجود هنا، كل ما أعرفه أنه ليس موجود هنا. أين ذهب؟ قال الذي أعرفه فقط أنه غير موجود هنا، أنتم عليكم أن تستووا، لأن نحن نريد مقابلته ضروري. لا بأس، استدعوه وابحثوا عنه. على أي حال، يقول أمير المؤمنين كانت هذه هي المؤامرة، أن أذهب للقاء الحاكم ثم تقدم إلي ورقة رسمية بأني متهم في قضية أسلم قريشي هذا، والمسألة تكون مرتبة ثم سجن ثم تتم هذه القضية الحمد لله التي فشلهم الله فيها ولم يتمكنوا منها. ولكن انظروا أصابع القدر في هذه الأمور البسيطة، وهو في المطار هؤلاء المسؤولين عن المطار يؤخروا الطائرة ساعة ويحاولون الاتصالات بالتليفونات بجميع المخابرات ولم يتم هذا الاتصال. من الذي عطل هذه الاتصالات وهذه المحاولات العديدة مع رجل الجوازات ومع رجال المطار؟ هي يد الله سبحانه وتعالى هي التي ترعى وهي التي توجه بهذه الأمور الإعجازية.
Another very interesting point came to my notice later on. That at the time when I was about to depart, scheduled to depart from Karachi, a head of state was also arriving at Karachi airport. And because I was occupying the same VIP area where he was to land, so many intelligence officers from different agencies were posted to welcome him and to see that he arrived safely, you know, to take care of his safe arrival and everything. Now, strange are Allah's ways. If they had come and he remained there while I was there, one of them would immediately know me and they would say, what are you doing here? Instead, his plane was delayed. It was delayed more than they delayed my plane. Fascinating. He arrived perhaps 2 o'clock or later, you know, while he was scheduled to arrive there after 12, before 1 o'clock. So these officers, instead of wasting their time sitting in this area, they went to the coffee room and they were enjoying gupshup and this and that. So when my plane was leaving, one of our party noticed some military and police officers, big officers, rushing to that area. So he suspected that perhaps they had got wind of my departure, and that is why this mad rush. So he inquired, what is happening? So he was told that, this story he was told, the plane is now about to arrive and we are going to take up our positions and see that everything is in order. But the timing made by Allah is so perfect, you know. Mm. And still people don't see the hand of God in this. I'm surprised.
يوضح أمير المؤمنين نقطة رابعة أو إصبع رابع من أصابع الله سبحانه وتعالى في هذه القضية والمسألة. يقول حضرته أنه في الوقت الذي كان مقدرا لطائرتي أن تخرج فيه بعد منتصف الليل بقليل، كان أيضا هناك أحد رؤساء الدول سيزور باكستان، وكان مقدرا لطائرته أن تصل تقريبا في نفس الوقت. ولذلك كان هناك عدد كبير من رجال المخابرات والمسؤولين عن حماية رئيس الدولة هذه وإعداد كل شيء له، ولكن هم أخروا طائرتي ساعة، وأخر الله طائرة هذا الرجل أكثر من ساعة، تأخرت كثيرا. ولذلك عمد هؤلاء رجال المخابرات أن يذهبوا ليستريحوا ليشربوا الشاي أو يفعلوا ما يفعلون من هذه الأمور. ولو أن أحدهم رأى أمير المؤمنين في قاعة كبار الزوار لتعرف عليه ولتغيرت هذه المسألة، ولكن الله سبحانه وتعالى جعلهم كلهم يذهبون إلى هذا ليشربوا شاي أو يدخنوا سجاير، وطائرة هذا الرئيس تأخرت أكثر من ساعتين حتى يتم هذا. الرجل الأحمدي الذي شاهد هذه المسألة يقول: بعد خروج أمير المؤمنين واتجاهي إلى الطائرة شاهدت عددا كبيرا من هؤلاء الأشخاص الضباط ويهرعون إلى قاعة كبار الزوار، فظننت أنهم اكتشفوا وجود أمير المؤمنين ويلحقون به ليقبضوا عليه. فلما سألت أحدهم ماذا ما الموضوع، قالوا طائرة رئيس الدولة قاربت المجيء ونحن وهكذا بفضل الله سبحانه وتعالى. رغم كل هذه الأشياء لا يزال هناك من لا يرى يد الله في هذه الأمور. متى تكون يد الله إذن؟ كيف نعرف يد الله إذا لم تكن في مثل هذه الترتيبات التي لا يملك الإنسان العادي أو غير العادي يملك فيها أي شيء؟
Now two things which I mentioned I think earlier as well, the reaction of Zia himself and the reaction of the mullahs. This reaction I showed you the papers was well organized and consolidated reaction. It had to be a reaction which was dictated and which told them to demand Mirza Tahir Ahmad's return through Interpol. All mullahs from all over Pakistan made this demand in public through newspapers, and they were published in all important papers that this man is fugitive from justice. And as a fugitive from justice, he should be forcibly returned to the country and handed over to the police for investigations. Now, why it didn't work, that is obvious. No call was issued to me at all for presentation. And until that time, there was no agreement either between government of Pakistan and the British government to return each other's criminals through Interpol. So first of all, they had to prove definitely that there was definitely a fugitive from justice, which of course there was no ground at all to stand on, and there was no proof whatsoever. But otherwise also this agreement between Pakistan, government of Pakistan and England has only been reached last year or the year before, and very recently, within a year or two. So at that time, the British government was not bound to return even a murderer, if it were a murderer. So all these were, factors which helped me, because Mullah Aslam Qureshi was yet in hiding. So the British government could genuinely believe that perhaps he is running away for his life because he is a murderer of that Mullah. There was every danger of their being duped into believing this. That's what I'm saying, that with the grace of Allah, because there was no Interpol agreement between Boston and the British, they couldn't do it anyway. But an effort was made. An effort was certainly made, because throughout it was the Foreign Office which was strongly advising the Home Office not to give me permit to stay here. And the matter was taken so seriously that the then Foreign Minister, Geoffrey Howe, I think it was, he wrote personal letters in his own hands to Leon Britton, who was the Home Minister at that time, to demand that my application for giving me permission to stay here as the Minister of Religion must be rejected and he should be sent back. But Allah knows best. No recommendation, we didn't even know that. Because all these things we learnt later on from some person who was working at a high level in these departments. He happened to be a friend of Ahmadis, so he told them, look here, do you know what was happening? They said, no, we have no idea. He said, well, I'm telling you, this is exactly what happened because he was dealing with those files. So if there is any breach of contract, it is his, not ours. But he conveyed the matter to a friend of his and he passed on everything to me. And I was surprised how Allah took care, because ordinarily it is not for the Home Office to reject a strong advice of the Foreign Office regarding a foreign visitor. It doesn't happen.
Yes.
And Leon Britton was so positive and strong about it that in the end he said, if you say this is against the British practice, against the British tradition, I remind you that I, as a minister, Home Minister or Secretary, Home Secretary, have a prerogative, an exceptional right through that clause to overrule these objections, and using this special authority I can permit anybody to come here and stay in this country. So I am going to utilize that exceptional right. Then the matter came to an end.
This is another law. Because why you should do
this? Why?
MashaAllah.
You know, we never dreamed of such things happening. And he didn't know Ahmadiyyat at all. This man, even today if you find, he doesn't know much about Ahmadiyyat. But God gave him strength to take up this line and he stood firm to this.
يشير أمير المؤمنين إلى موضوع آخر يتعلق بعد عودته بعد مجيئه إلى بريطانيا وذكر لنا غضبة ضياء الحق والمشايخ وكيف أنه أوحى إليهم أن يقوموا بأعمال ومظاهرات ونداءات تطالب بإعادة ميرزا طاهر أحمد إلى باكستان مرة أخرى. كان هناك إجماع في الصحف لهؤلاء التي يكتب فيها هؤلاء المشايخ أن أسلم قريشي لابد من التحقيق في قضيته ولابد من إعادة ميرزا طاهر أحمد مرة أخرى إلى باكستان. يقول أمير المؤمنين أنه لم تكن هناك في ذلك الوقت اتفاقية بين باكستان وبين الحكومة البريطانية لتبادل المجرمين أو هذه المسائل القضائية. والآن يوجد هذا الاتفاق بينهما منذ عام أو منذ عامين. إذن لا تستطيع الحكومة البريطانية أن تسلمه إلى الحكومة الباكستانية، ولكن وزير الخارجية نتيجة الضغوط التي تمت من باكستان عليه كتب رسالة بيده يطلب من الداخلية في بريطانيا ألا تقبل بقاءه في بريطانيا ولا قبوله في بريطانيا كرجل من رجال الدين المسلمين، ولكن يد الله تتدخل مرة أخرى، لأن وزير الداخلية في بريطانيا قال أن من حقي أنا حتى لو كانت كل هذه الأمور موجودة من حقي أن أتخطى كل هذه الأمور، وخالف زميله وزير الخارجية فلم يصدر أمرا بعدم قبول مولانا أمير المؤمنين في بريطانيا. هذا الرجل ليس أحمديا ولا حتى كان يعرف الأحمديين، ولكن الله ثبته وجعله يقف هذا الموقف الذي تأخذه بلده عادة بالنسبة للذين يلجؤون إليها. ما دام لا يوجد هناك دليل حقيقي على أنه مطالب من القانون ولم تصدر ضده من أي محكمة أو من أي هيئة قضائية في باكستان تستدعيه للمسؤول أمامهم، هذا كله مجرد أقوال لا حقيقة وراءها. لذلك لم يرى الرجل أن هذه القضية قضية حقيقية، رغم وجود احتمال من أن هناك يكون هاربا لأن أسلم قريشي كان مختفيا إلى ذلك الوقت وأنه فر إلى بريطانيا، ولكن لأنه لم تصدر أي أوراق رسمية أو تعاملات رسمية من الحكومة الباكستانية، لذلك أصر الرجل ولم يقبل بطلب وزير الخارجية ووافق على بقاء أمير المؤمنين في بريطانيا.
ما Now, why did I mention this contract by, what do you say? The contract between the two governments on Interpol, it's a matter of choice of the governments, it's not a universal thing. Why it was important that it had not yet been signed? Because if the foreign minister had quoted this, then the home minister had no authority to defy that. Then he would have to succumb, he would certainly succumb to their demand. So that is why he beat about the bush but couldn't say anything about it, because the home office could say, no, there is no such law, even if he is a criminal, you know, that sort of thing. So what they did, they took a different line. In one of the arguments, they raised many points, in fact. They said, look here, you can't, don't you realize that Mirza Tahir Ahmad from your soil, the British soil, will abuse Pakistan and criticize Pakistan openly. And this will drag us into a very embarrassing position, because it is the Foreign Office which has to face the music. And they will keep on protesting to us, look here, there is somebody sitting on your soil and openly criticizing the government of Pakistan. Why are you nurturing him? Why are you providing him canopy to do whatever he likes? This was the, you know, essence of what the argument was about. I mean, the wording had to be different, but this is what it meant. When this was conveyed to the Home Minister, you know, he said, we have been watching. And so far, in none of his sermons, Mr. Tahir Ahmad has said a single word against government of Pakistan by reflection or directly. It so happened, with the grace of Allah, that I hadn't said anything. And it, you know, just it grew from within me. Now, they were watching me so intently and taking such care of what I was doing, that in response to that, the Foreign Office told the Home Office, although he is not doing it here, but when he goes out in Holland recently, when he visited Holland, he delivered a very obnoxious address, a speech, which was objectionable from the point of view of the government, criticizing the government of Pakistan and this and that. So the response was, he has not done anything here. If he violates any laws of Holland, let them take care. To the knowledge of the Home Office, according to our intelligence reports, he has not uttered a single word. Now, if the matter was, they have not left at that. This Foreign Office was very tenacious in the pursuance of the matter. They said, all right, if he has not done it, take it for granted that the moment you give him permission to stay here, he will start speaking. And there, I think they were right. I must give them credit for this intelligence.
يشير أمير المؤمنين إلى نقطة أخرى، وهو أن هذا وزير الخارجية كان يلح ويصر على مسألة هذا، ولو كان هناك أي اتفاق بين حكومة باكستان وبريطانيا فيما يتعلق بمثل هذه الأمور، تبادل الأشخاص المقبوض عليهم أو المطلوبين، لما استطاع وزير الداخلية أن يتصرف في هذه المسألة، وكانت الموضوع وكان الموضوع يكون منتهيا. ولكن وزير الخارجية دخل من نقطة من باب آخر، وقال إنه إذا سمحتم له بالبقاء في بريطانيا فإنه سوف يهاجم حكومة باكستان وسوف ينتقدها وسوف يضعنا نحن في الخارجية، سيضعنا في موقف حرج أمام هذه الحكومة وسوف يحتجون علينا وسوف وسوف. قالوا له، نحن راقبناه ولا نزال نراقبه، ولم يحدث منه في أي خطبة أو في أي لقاء أنه وجه أي حديث ناقد إلى حكومة باكستان أو إلى غيرها، فهو لم يحدث منه ذلك. قال لهم، وقال وزير الخارجية، لكنه ذهب إلى هولندا وهناك خطب خطبة انتقد فيها حكومة باكستان. قالوا إنه هذا تم في هولندا لم يحدث عندنا في بلدنا لم يحدث منها يتصرف. إذا كان فعل ذلك في هولندا فهولندا تتصرف معه ولا تعطيه تأشيرة للدخول، لكن عندنا لم يحدث منه أي شيء. قال تأكدوا أنه عندما يحصل على حق البقاء هنا فسوف ينتقد. يقول أمير المؤمنين هذا صحيح، فإنني بعد ذلك انتقدتهم.
I didn't even know the name of the Home Minister. You know how I learned the name? When a British author wanted to write a book on me, which is entitled A Man of God, now it's published, he wanted to find more about my departure and how, you know, it came about and things, and the reaction of the British government to this. So I generally told him that there was a difference of opinion between the Ministry of for the Foreign Ministry and the Home Ministry about this, and I told him it was Douglas Hurd who was the Home Minister, so I should be grateful to this gentleman. Now this man happened to know Douglas Hurd and his attitude in general. He wouldn't believe. He said, Douglas, I won't give credence to this report. I must find out. It was he who made inquiry, and he came to his life laughing. He said, I was right. It was not Douglas Hurd, it was Leon Britton at that time, because I have checked the official record. I mean, he inquired from the ministry. So, you know, our involvement was so... There's no involvement, I mean, absolutely. I didn't even know the name of the Home Minister. And it happened through him later on that I came to know that it was not Douglas Hurd, but it was Liam Britton. And ever since I have not made any contact with him. We don't know each other. So this is Allah's way, and this is what I'm stressing. How Allah brings about things by himself and takes care of everything.
يقول أمير المؤمنين أنا لم تكن لي علاقة بوزير الداخلية هذا الذي تبنى هذه القضية وأصر على موقفه، لم أكن حتى أعرفه، ولكن اكتشفنا هذه المسألة لأن أحد الكتاب البريطانيين بريطاني الجنسية أراد أن يكتب كتابا عني تحت اسم A Man of God، وقد كتب هذا الكتاب ووزع وموجود في السوق. هذا الرجل أراد أن يعرف بعض المعلومات عن كيف دخلت بريطانيا وكيف حصلت على الإقامة وما مثل هذه الأمور، فقلت له أن وزير الداخلية سير دوغلاس هيرد هو الذي فعل ذلك، وكان هناك خلاف بينه وبين وزير الخارجية ولكنه أصر على موقفه. يقول هذا الكاتب لأمير المؤمنين أنا لا أصدق هذا، لا يمكن أن يكون الموقف بهذه الطريقة. ثم ذهب هو بنفسه وتحرى، فلم يكن فعلا دوغلاس هيرد هو وزير الداخلية في ذلك الوقت، ولكن وزير الداخلية كان مستر بريتون
ليون
بريتون، وأن هذا الرجل هو الذي فعل ذلك. قال له انظر أنا وجهة نظري صحيحة، دوغلاس هيرد ما كان أبدا يقف مثل هذا الموقف، ولكن هذا الرجل وقف هذا الموقف بتوجيه من الله سبحانه وتعالى.
Now, what followed is also a very interesting episode which should be pursued. You know, they all blemished my image and tarnished my name by painting me as a fugitive from justice. They continued, even after the discovery of Aslam Qureshi, they continued bragging about it. He's a fugitive of justice, he's run away from justice. He calls it, say, hijra. How can be a hijra because he's a criminal man? But the first hijra of Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, they forget, was after he murdered somebody by mistake, whatever you call it. But he migrated from his land because of that his involvement in a murder. Now, it's so strange that Hazrat Masih alayhi salatu wasalam was told that a time would come upon you which would be like Zamane Musa, like the age of Moses. And Hazrat Masih alayhi salatu wasalam said that to my understanding it cannot happen. No such thing can happen in my lifetime. So it has to be in the lifetime of some Khalifa of mine later on. And Hazrat Muslim Maud, my late father, speaking on this, interpreted exactly like this. That this ilham of Muslim Maud will get fulfilled later on during the lifetime of another Khalifa, not in my lifetime. So when they started talking about murder and run away, then my attention was drawn to it and some others started writing to me, other Ahmadis. It's a strange thing. That zaman has come, a pharaoh of the time is pursuing you. And he was pursuing you with all his might and army and laws and things. And God made you escape him. And strangely enough, there was a murder case hanging on you as well as like it was hanging on the name of Moses. But still, I mean, these old mullahs would continue to brag about and boast about my escape from justice, as they called it.
يوضح أمير المؤمنين نقطة أخرى. النقاط كثيرة وكلها تشير إلى يد الله سبحانه وتعالى. يقول حضرته أن بعد هجرتي إلى هنا كان هؤلاء الشيوخ يسيرون كثيرا من الأقاويل يلطخون سمعتي ويتهمونني. ماذا يقول؟ يقول إنه هاجر، إنه هارب من العدالة، العدالة التي يعرفون، هارب من القانون. يقول حضرته أن هذا يشبه حادثة سيدنا موسى عليه الصلاة والسلام عندما تورط في مسألة قتل رغما عنه ولم يكن يقصدها، فكان اضطر إلى الهجرة من مصر إلى سيناء. يقول حضرته أن هناك إلهام لسيدنا الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود، يقول هذا الإلهام سيأتي عليك وقت كزمن موسى. عندما تدبر سيدنا الإمام المهدي في هذا القول قال ليس هناك ما يمكن أن يحدث في زمن موسى ويحدث في زمني.
Because he was not serving under any pharaoh.
لأنه في ذلك الوقت لم يكن هناك فرعون. أين فرعون هذا الذي سأكون أنا بالنسبة له موسى؟
He was not even born at that time. That pharaoh.
يقول حضرته
who was to capture me under the
هذا الفرعون
he was not yet born.
يقول حضرته أن هذا الفرعون لم يكن قد ولد بعد. على أي حال، الخليفة الثاني رضي الله تعالى عن فسر هذا الإلهام أو انطباعه عن هذا الإلهام بأن هذا الموقف سوف يحدث فيما بعد مع أحد خلفاء سيدنا الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود. الخليفة الثاني هو والد سيدنا الإمام. يقول حضرته أن هذا بالفعل هو ما حدث، فهذا فرعون الزمن هذا ضياء الحق كان يطالب برقبتي، ولكن الله نجاني كما نجى موسى.
Now another very interesting thing. They claim that your hijrat is false, it is not blessed by God, you are just a fugitive, and we demand that you should be brought back and hanged there. If this is true, this claim, then all the promises relating to hijrah by Allah should not have applied to me in my case. Because Allah says, whoever does hijrah in my name and for my sake, we bless him, we give him a much wider area and, you know, saw and everything awaits for him. And then whoever pursues him, he receives the wrath of Allah. This is an established sunnah of Allah from the study of the Holy Quran. Now, if they ever read the Quran, why don't they think, why don't they apply this to this case to judge whether it was an escape from justice or was it a sunnah of Allah being realized once again in our case? So this was definitely the blessing of Allah, because what happened to Zia, I'll come to that and you'll be surprised at things. Unbelievable things happened, and God had told me before that incident that Zia is about to be destroyed. And I had made it a public secret, I mean a public announcement, through sermon, that this is what's going to happen, but we'll come to that later on. But what happened to me and my jama'ah, Does Allah treat fugitives from justice like this? You know, the rate of the progress of Jamaat has risen 100 times more than when I was in Pakistan. It's growing 100 times faster. What if we had remained in Pakistan, the progress we might have made in 100 years, this is the meaning of it. We are making every single year with the grace of Allah. This is how Allah treats the fugitives from justice.
يوضح أمير المؤمنين ويقول أن هؤلاء الملات الذين يقولون أن هذه ليست هجرة وإنما هي هروب من العدالة ولا يزالون يقولون ذلك بالرغم من أن أسلم قريشي الذي اتهمت بقتله ظهر ولم أقتله ولم أمسه ولم يكن بيني وبينه أي علاقة ولم يختشوا لأنهم هكذا يكذبون ومع ذلك يصرون على هذه الأقوال. المهم يقول حضرته أن هذا خروجي من باكستان إلى بريطانيا كانت هجرة بحسب المعايير القرآنية. فلننظر ماذا جرى لي أنا وماذا جرى لجماعتي. طبقا للقرآن، القرآن يقول ومن يهاجر في سبيل الله يجد مراغما كثيرا وسعة. الذي يخرج في سبيل الله يوسع عليه وييسر له الأمور ويجعل الفلاح والنجاح في طريقه. هذا كله ما حصل لي وما حصل لجماعتي. إن جماعتي اليوم تقطع في سنة ما كانت تقطعه في 100 سنة لو ظللت في مكاني في باكستان. فكانت هجرة كلها خير وبركة، تضاعفت سرعة الجماعة إلى 100 مرة. وهذا الذي كان يطاردني والذي هاجرت بسببه، ماذا فعل الله به؟ هذا ما سوف يحكي لنا أمير المؤمنين ماذا حدث له. وإن كنا جميعا نعرف أنه تفجر في السماء ولم يبق منه شيء. ألا يقرؤون القرآن؟ ألا يتأملون؟ إذا لم تكن هذه هجرة وإذا لم تكن يد الله في هذه الأمور الواضحة، إذن أين تكون يد الله إذن؟
إن شاء الله. The rest I'll tell tomorrow.
إن شاء الله.
We'll continue on the same.
نكمل إن شاء الله غدا. نذكر الإخوة المشاهدين أن يتصلوا بنا وأن يرسلوا إلينا في عنواننا ما يعن لهم من أسئلة ومن ملاحظات. وجزاكم الله، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.